In this Layer for Sci video, we're going to look at the reaction and mechanism between a nitrile and Grignard to form a ketone, along with a shortcut to quickly identify the products. The mechanism can look overwhelming, so here's what I want you to recognize. A nitrile has a carbon triple bound to a nitrogen, and the ketone does not have a nitrogen. Therefore, in this mechanism, we have to break the bonds between carbon and nitrogen one at a time, and replace the bonds on nitrogen with hydrogen. Grignard wants to attack the nitrile because the bond between carbon and nitrogen is polar. Carbon is partially positive and nitrogen is partially negative. And as we know about Grignard reagents, which I teach on my website linked below or at layerforsci.com/Grignard, the Grignard carbon is very nucleophilic and it's looking for positive charge. And so the electrons between carbon and magnesium will reach for that partially positive carbon atom, forming too many bonds, and so kicking out the first bond between carbon and nitrogen. This gives us a carbon that now has two bonds to nitrogen, the initial lone pair, as well as the new pair that came from that triple bond with a negative charge, and a single bond between carbon and the incoming Grignard methyl group. Now that the Grignard is destroyed with an MgBr plus cation in solution, now we can bring in acid, which earlier would have destroyed the Grignard. Nitrogen will use its negative electrons to reach for that hydrogen, collapsing those electrons back onto oxygen for a molecule that looks like this. Nitrogen now has just one lone pair and that hydrogen atom, giving me this neutral imine. The next phase of this reaction is to hydrolyze the imine to give us a ketone by slowly adding hydrogen onto the nitrogen. Given that we're in an acidic solution, nitrogen's lone pair of electrons is most nucleophilic and will reach out for the proton on another hydronium, collapsing these electrons onto oxygen, giving us an iminium, which is a carbon double bound to nitrogen, two hydrogen atoms, no lone pairs, and a positive charge. Even though the positive charge sits on the nitrogen, nitrogen is still an electronegative atom, and we'll start pulling on the electron density between itself and carbon, making this carbon very partially positive. This will attract the electronegative oxygen on water to attack the carbon and collapse the electrons between carbon and nitrogen up onto the nitrogen to give us a molecule that now has a single bond between carbon and nitrogen, two hydrogen atoms, and one lone pair for no charge. And let's not forget the oxonium, which is oxygen bound to carbon with only one lone pair and a positive charge. For the next step, we have a proton transfer, which can be shown in two different ways. Some professors will allow you to show an internal proton transfer, where the neutral nitrogen will grab a proton, collapsing the electrons back onto oxygen. Other professors want you to show it in two distinct steps as follows. Step one, a water molecule in solution grabs that proton, giving oxygen back its electrons. And step two, which I'll show in the same drawing, nitrogen reaches for a hydrogen off another hydronium molecule, giving oxygen back its electrons, for what ultimately looks like a proton transfer. Because nitrogen now has three protons, one from the first proton transfer, second proton transfer, and the one it just grabbed in solution. Since it has four bonds and no electrons, it gets a positive charge. Meanwhile, the oxygen has its initial lone pair, along with the electrons that came from the bond between itself and hydrogen, making it neutral. But this molecule is still unstable because of the positive nitrogen, which again makes carbon partially positive, attracting this oxygen to attack as follows. Oxygen will use its lone electrons to collapse towards the carbon, forming a pi bond, forming too many bonds to carbon, which will kick out the best leaving group, a nitrogen with three bonds, which gives us a molecule that looks like this. We have our initial skeleton. I'm going to move the oxygen up here with the initial bond from when the oxygen attacked and the second bond from the electrons that collapsed towards the carbon. Oxygen has one hydrogen atom and it still has one lone pair of electrons for a positive charge. Off in solution, we have the nitrogen with its three hydrogen atoms from the three subsequent attacks, along with a lone pair that it got from being kicked off the carbon atom. Nitrogen, in this case ammonia, is happy to float away somewhere in solution. But we still have to get rid of that positive charge, which happens when yet another water molecule in solution uses its electrons to grab the hydrogen and give oxygen back the electrons to finally give us our final product, which is our carbon skeleton with a double bond to oxygen, the initial lone pair, and the lone pair just got from the proton removal. Wow, that's a lot. I challenge you to go back to this reaction and ask yourself, what is the pattern? And notice that we simply had a series of steps for protonating nitrogen and breaking the bonds between carbon and nitrogen. Now that we have the mechanism, let's look at a shortcut to quickly identify the product without having to draw out all the steps. But first, make sure you give this video a thumbs up, subscribe to my channel, and hit that bell notification so you don't miss out on any new videos. As soon as you identify a nitrile reacting with a Grignard, know that your product is going to be a ketone as follows. Break the bond completely between carbon and nitrogen. To redraw your skeleton with just a carbon, put a carbonyl onto that carbon, and then add a single bond to the R group that came from the Grignard, in this case a methyl. For even more on Grignard reactions, along with the Grignard cheat sheet, visit my website, linked below, or go to layerforsci.com/Grignard. The link again, layerforsci.com/Grignard.